Top Benedict.
Oh, unfortunate.
Remember, it's a two-stroke penalty if you're beyond the boundary.
Two.
Blazes, has he gone? Benedict! Hurry on!
If you haven't found it by now, you've bloody well lost it!
No lifting out of a difficulty, Benedict!
We may as well help. We'll fan out, shall we?
Almost ready.
He's had his daily romp and a bath. I dare say he's rather hungry, aren't you, little Roland?
Just... One drop of lime extract.
He has milk, fresh diapers, and enough solid food to last him the whole day.
I'll take him for the morning and bring him to you at lunchtime. Oh.
Murdoch residence. Detective William Murdoch speaking. I see. Yes, I'll be right there.
It appears little Roland will be spending his morning in the morgue.
Wait, you go take a look that way.
What have we, George?
Sir,
thank
I'm
you.
Just arriving myself, but it seems a group of four were out on the links. One of them went into the woods to retrieve his ball, and that was the last anybody's seen of him.
Was a search conducted?
By his colleagues, yes. They claim he vanished without a trace. This must be them, sir.
Ah, Constable Crabtree, a pleasure to see you again. I'm only sorry it is under such worrisome circumstances.
And you are?
Sir, this is Roger Newsome of the Mimico Newsomes. He was mixed up
with the auto club, yes. Mr. Newsome, what do you know of this disappearance?
What can be said? He abandoned a round in progress.
What kind of man does that?
I certainly won't be signing his scorecard.
Where did he enter the woods?
Given all these broken branches, and the fact that the ground's been disturbed in several places, I'd say someone's been through here recently. The trail seems to end here.
Well, in that case, sir, he may have been snatched. Somebody in some sort of dirigible.
George.
Well, it's happened before, sir.
I don't think he went up.
That's quicksand. Be careful. There's very little in nature more dangerous than quicksand.
Contrary to popular belief and many books, it's virtually impossible to be sucked under whilst in quicksand, George. But that's not to say he wasn't put here. Get him to the morgue so he can be cleaned up and examined. Did your search yield anything, George?
We discovered a ball, sir. Presumably the one the victim was looking for. Sir, I have a request.
Yes?
As you may know, Mr. Newsome and I have some history. He treated me terribly in our last encounter, and I... Well, sir, I hate him.
Oh?
I feel bad even thinking it, sir, but I can't pretend it's not true. I hate the way he acts and the way he speaks and the way he laughs, and I hate his little bow tie and his stupid face.
Thank you, George.
I apologize. I wonder if I should be excused from the case given my personal bias.
Well, so long as I remain unbiased, I don't see the problem, George. I'll see you back at the station house.
Oh, Benedict. Benny.
I just keep asking myself the same question. How? How can I go on? How?
Do you know of anyone who may have wished the victim harm?
No.
No. Look, every member of this club regarded him with fondness and esteem.
James Benedict was a gift from above.
I'm very sorry we can't be of more help, Detective. As I'm sure you know, I am a great friend of the constabulary.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Oh, Detective. George Lyon, club champion.
William Murdoch, Toronto Constabulary.
Most shocking news. Have you any idea how it happened?
My investigation is still in the early stages.
Someone killed him while I was golfing only a few holes away. Shameful. Outrageous. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm set for another 18.
The victim was struck with a blunt instrument and beaten repeatedly about the head.
So he died from his injuries?
He was alive and breathing when he went into the quicksand. Cause of death was asphyxiation.
Would you be able to tell what type of weapon was used?
There were some distinct marks, both the cranium and the upper torso. I think it would be fair to assume it was a golf club.
Well, the victim's club was found on the scene. If I brought it in, would you be able to tell if it's a match?
Certainly do my best.
I finished transcribing the marks from the victim's back.
Marks?
He had a series of tiny punctures on his shoulder blade, about a dozen in total.
I've made a card with the location of the holes. The wound could have been made by a man's shoe, or rather, cleats.
Very good, Miss James. I'll see if this pattern is a match for any of the player's cleats.
I suppose that means you'll be leaving little Roland with me.
He seems much happier here.
So this punter hits the ball into the woods off the tee, goes looking for it, and someone clubs him.
And since it would be impossible to anticipate Mr. Benedict directing the ball into the woods on that hole, we have to assume that it was a crime of opportunity.
I suppose it could have been a golfer on a neighboring hole. Or what if he meant to do it?
I'm afraid I don't follow.
Golf is a cruel mistress, Murdoch. It holds a man under its spell. I could believe that he hit the ball into the woods on purpose, then killed himself just to get away from the game.
Golf seems little more than a distraction, sir. I can hardly believe that it would drive a man to suicide.
Seems like fun at first. Just one good round. Even one good shot. And you're hooked. You become a slave to it. For hours and hours, day after day, you hit the ball towards the hole. You hit the ball towards the hole, on and on. Gets into your head. It consumes you. All you can think about is hitting the damn ball into the damn hole. Golf is a curse, Murdoch. Don't you forget it.
Oh, Detective. Mr. Lyon, so what do we owe the pleasure?
I have something terribly important to discuss with you.
Oh, regarding Mr. Benedict's death?
No, sir, regarding your death.
Is that some sort of threat, Mr. Lyon?
A threat? My good man, I'm talking about insurance. Detective, I'm here to offer you the security and well-being that can only be attained through the purchase of a full coverage insurance policy.
Oh, I really don't think
you have a wife, Detective, children?
Yes.
And What would happen to them if something unspeakable were to happen to you?
What
would become of your beautiful family should some fiery blaze engulf your peaceful home?
I don't know.
These are unponderable questions, sir. And their only answer is insurance.
Mr. Lyon, have you sold insurance policies to members of the golf club?
To nearly every member. Golf has become my passion, but insurance remains my business. Next year, it will finance my trip to St. Louis to play in the Olympic Games.
Oh. And did you sell such a policy to Mr. Benedict?
I'll tell you all you care to know about if you would play around with me. No one goes uninsured after 18 holes with George Lyon.
Murdoch, I've sent Crabtree to the golf club to look for a match on those golf cleats.
Sir, allow me to introduce Mr. George Lyon, one of our country's finest golfers.
Oh, are you?
Oh, Inspector, it's a pleasure. Would you care to join us for a round?
Us?
Oh, well, sir, it could only aid in the investigation.
Curse, Murdoch. Curse.
Mark's too narrow.
I'll try the other side.
You mark my words, Doctor. Keep your eye on your husband or you're going to lose him.
William Murdoch is a man of discipline. I'm sure he can handle a round of golf.
This one still isn't as wide as the ones on the body.
It seems the weapon may have had a flat edge to it.
Forewarned is forearmed, Mrs. Murdoch.
I can't imagine why anyone would enjoy this sport at all. It seems rather silly.
I thought that too until I started swinging this club about. It's quite pleasurable.
Very nice.
Thank you.
Was the victim's policy significant?
The beneficiary is in line for $50,000.
Who would that be?
I'll check my records as soon as I get back to the office and we'll contact you directly.
And what of Mr. Benedict's foursome?
Loyal friends. They do circumvent course policy on one matter, though. They play four-ball golf for money.
Oh? Any significant sums?
Sometimes up to 50 cents a hole. Go ahead, detective. Strike it with some gusto. Well, well, well. Very fine. You have a lovely swing, detective. Now, I do have some pointers for you.
Well, come now, Constable Crabtree. This is nothing more than a charade. I can tell you who the killer is.
I'm not interested in your theories, Mr. Newsom.
It was Benedict's brother, Wilbur. The man is truly a weasel.
Or sherry, man. What's the damnable holdup?
A weasel through and through. A scoundrel, I dare say.
The last time I was stuck playing with him, he refused to do the proper ball drop behind his head.
You mean he just dropped it in front of him?
Yes.
You three realize you're the prime suspects in a murder investigation, don't you?
How can you say such a thing?
Because you're the ones who were with Mr. Benedict just prior to his death. You know that Wilbur Benedict was seen here in the clubhouse, so how could he magically appear at the crime scene just at the right time?
Anyone here in the clubhouse could have stepped out the back and nipped into those woods.
Oh, my. That is quite the getup.
They allow for terrific mobility.
I have news regarding the victim's club.
Oh, yes. Was it used in the murder?
I don't believe so. It seems the wounds were made by a club with a narrow base and a flattened head.
That would be a putter, no doubt.
So the murder weapon is still missing.
You two seem to be making a fine day of it.
You should join us for a round sometime. You must be Mrs. Murdoch, George Lyon.
Dr. Julia Ogden, I appreciate the offer, but I'm afraid I must be getting back to work.
Another time, then.
Oh, fine putt.
Thank you.
I'll be along to take care of Roland as soon as I finish with golf.
Let's go, detective.
The
pattern of cleat marks wasn't much help, sir. It matches a popular shoe worn by at least a dozen men here.
Including all the members of the victim's foursome. Gentlemen, a few more questions.
Come now, Detective Murdoch. We were just about to enjoy a round.
Seems Mr. Newsom's lost his putter.
Indeed. How do you explain that, Mr. Newsom?
I threw it into the water hazard some time ago.
Why would you do that?
It had become disagreeable. Putting with my driver has brought my handicap down to a half one.
Did either of you witness the discarding of this putter?
No.
Well, that's convenient. Not to mention hard to believe. How could a golfer become so upset that he would throw perfectly good golf clubs into a lake? Clearly, the errors in your putting were the fault of your stroke and not of your club.
It was, too, the putter's fault.
Be that as it may, if that club was used in a murder, Mr. Newsom, that club will lead you to the noose.
I think that's a lot of them, sir.
I find it astounding that so many golfers resort to throwing perfectly good equipment into a lake.
A man in the grip of obsession knows no reason, Murdoch.
Sir, this one matches Mr. Newsom's description. It has his initials monogrammed in it.
It appears to have been underwater for some time, undisturbed. I think we have to rule this out as the murder weapon.
So Newsom's not our killer?
Well, that's yet to be determined, George, but this club didn't kill Mr. Benedict. The victim was killed in this wooded area here. Quicksand would be roughly here.
Mr. Newsom said he entered the woods first. The Driscoll and Saunders went further down the fairway.
Even if one of the foursome is the killer, he would have had to dispose of the murder weapon somewhere in that direction.
Maybe he dropped it in someone's bag on the 16th.
There's a pond on the 16th. I nearly hit into it during my round with Mr. Lula.
Close enough for the killer to throw something in there.
Oh, sirs. May I at least get my trunks first? Six golf clubs, sir, and a coat of slime, and that filthy water from the lake in my ear. I swear I can feel the germs making their way into my brain. Germs can be quite deadly, can't they?
Yes.
Really?
Two putters, both fairly rusty. And this.
It's quite unusual, sir. Is that a putter also?
Oh, it does have a flat face. It's rather unwieldy, though.
Looks to be in good shape, though, sir. I wouldn't say it's been in the water long.
Indeed. I'll have Dr. Ogden see if it's a match to the victim's wound.
It's fun, isn't it?
This part is fun. It's the wandering around endlessly after a tiny white ball that doesn't seem so appealing.
I prefer to look at it as a pleasant walk in a beautiful setting.
I can do that in Hyde Park, for free.
I believe we've found our culprit.
Well, given its unique design, someone at the club will know who it belongs to.
Then I suppose you'd be sending a constable to ask around.
Oh, I was thinking I would go myself. Mr. Lyon knows everyone at the club. If I speak to him, I'll have my answer directly.
And if he happens to ask you to play a round of golf?
I'll have to check the etiquette on that.
Oh. Hit another, detective. It's only a friendly round. I'll bend the rules to grant you a mulligan, but the removal of loose impediments is strictly prohibited.
Oh. Thank you, Mr. Lyon. Sheer volume of golf etiquette. Somewhat daunting.
And as important as the game itself.
Now, what of this putter? Is it familiar to you?
Seen it only once before. Odd piece of equipment, isn't it? Even if it works, you look like a fool using it.
Did you happen to notice who it belonged to?
McIver, a Scotsman. Daft man purchases every newfangled thing that promises the slightest improvement to his game. I'll telephone him this afternoon and send him straight over to you.
Oh, and did you find out who the beneficiary is of Mr. Benedict's insurance policy?
Next of kin. In this case, his brother, Wilbur Benedict.
Also a member of this club, I believe. Thank you, Mr. Lyon.
while, you'll get the hang of it.
I don't understand. I hit the ball perfectly before.
Such is the nature of the game, Detective. As unpredictable as life itself. Of course, insurance allows us to guard against life's calamity. In golf, there are no such assurances. A perfect swing every time. That would be mastering the unmasterable.
What's this then?
Oh, sir, I've had an idea. It's an invention.
What's he do? Force a man to confess?
No. 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 It will allow me to...
Look, give it a rest and get back to work. There's a churlish Scotsman sitting in your office.
Churlish? How so?
Well, he's a Scotsman, isn't he?
Ah, practical golf. A tome as sacred as the King James Bible, eh?
Do you recognize this putter?
Aye, surely. Bought it 2 months ago. Useless as a fat man at the high jump.
This is your putter?
No any longer, no. Sold it 3 weeks back.
To whom did you sell it?
That right drunk duffer, Wilbur. Wilbur Benedict.
Oh, Mr. Benedict. Detective William Murdoch.
Yes, yes.
What?
I'd like to speak with you regarding your brother's death. Do you recognize this putter?
Of course, what of it?
Does it belong to you?
I have one just like it, but mine is in my golf bag, secured in my locker.
Are you quite sure about that? Because this is your golf bag, and there's no putter in it.
And this was used to murder your brother, Mr. Benedict.
Let's take a walk, shall we, sunshine?
If someone used my putter to murder poor James, it certainly had nothing to do with me. Anyone could have taken it from my locker.
And I haven't used my clubs in weeks.
But you were at the clubhouse every day.
The clubhouse, not the course. My physician told me I have to stay off my hip, so I wound my time at the bar.
The perfect place to lie in wait. The spot where your brother was murdered is only a short distance away from the clubhouse's back door.
You think I slipped out between sherries to murder poor Jimmy Boy? It's preposterous. Why would I do such a thing?
You're the beneficiary for his life insurance policy.
Oh, I am not.
You deny it.
I used to be his beneficiary, but then Jimmy Boy decided to cancel his insurance last month.
Hello? Detective.
Oh, Mr. Lyon. Thank you for coming.
My, oh, my. Whatever is this?
I call it my swing arc perfection device. As you can see, the device helps to guide your backswing. Now, if you make an error, the device lets you know. Whereas, if you keep the club between the rails, you have a perfect swing.
It's quite clever, Detective. I'm not sure the likes of George Lyon can benefit. My swing is already one of the purest in the game.
But is it perfect every time?
Well, perhaps not every time.
This device ensures that your swing will become consistent. But think of it as insurance.
All right, all right. Let's have a go. Thank you. Ah!
The reason I asked you here today, Mr. Lyon, was to discuss James Benedict's insurance policy.
Yes.
We've come to learn that Mr. Benedict intended to cancel the policy.
Certainly did. End of last month. Wanted to cancel the whole lot.
And why were the policies not canceled?
Took him for a round and convinced him to reconsider. Ingenious. I can start to feel my swing improving already.
Afternoon, Miss James. Is the doctor in?
I'm afraid she's gone for the day, Constable. Taking care of the little one. Is there something I can help you with?
Well, I actually do have a bit of a medical issue.
What seems to be the trouble?
I've got water stuck in my ear. And not just any water, filthy, filthy, stagnant pond water, rife with germs and microscopic diseases, to be sure.
Is that so?
Yes, that's so. I've been reading up on it in the library. You wouldn't believe it. There are several recorded instances of dirty water causing fatal infections.
Every patient who looks up their symptoms at the library ends up thinking they're dying. Diagnosis is best left to the professionals. That said, you might lose your ear.
What? Yeah. Oh, my goodness. It's gone. You've cured me.
Rubbing alcohol and vinegar. I learned it from my mother. For next time.
Thank you, Miss James.
It's possible Mr. Benedict killed his brother for the insurance. But it's also equally possible that he knew about the policy being canceled.
You do realize you're missing the obvious, Murdoch.
Sir?
George Lyon, your new pal. He's the one with motive. He stands to lose his commission if a policy is canceled before the company can earn it back.
Sir, you believe Mr. Lyon failed to convince Mr. Benedict to reconsider?
And killed him to stop him from canceling. Must need the cash to go off gallivanting to the Olympic Games.
Sir, Mr. Lyon wasn't part of the foursome on course. And his cleats didn't match the marks on the body. It can't be him.
You're off to play with Lyon now, I presume.
As a matter of fact, I am.
You don't think your personal feelings about the man are clouding your judgment, do you?
Absolutely not.
Good.
Good.
Crabtree, come here. Need your help.
What's the problem, sir?
Murdoch has bungled this golf club murder.
How so?
He's fallen in love with the game. The temptress has blinded him. He thinks George Lyon can do no wrong.
You think Mr. Lyon is guilty, then?
I don't know. When did you check the pattern on his golf cleats? Do you think he could have changed them?
Sir, Mr. Lyon's cleats were never checked. He was out on the course with the detective and never came back to the clubhouse.
The bugger swerved it. Let's go, Crabtree.
Where was Lyon when Benedict went into the woods?
It's hard to say. He was playing as a single and asked to play through at some point.
Yes, yes, that's right. I remember noticing his plus fours. I thought I would look quite fine in those and went straight out to buy myself a pair that afternoon.
The afternoon your friend was murdered?
I purchased them whilst carrying the heaviest of hearts.
Oh, yes, I'm sure you were just devastated. What hole did you see him on?
Constable Crabtree. Do I sense sarcasm?
Shut up, Newsome. Where were you on the course when you saw Lyon?
I don't remember.
It was the hole that Sanders yelled at Benedict. Sanders, what hole was that?
Yelling at the victim. What about?
He was cleaning his ball.
And?
Well, it was during play. And as such, strictly prohibited.
Oh, for the love of Ada. Which hole was it?
13th. He claimed ground under repair, but the circumstances called for no relief.
13th? Benedict was killed on the 14th.
That's right.
Come on, Crabtree.
Constable Crabtree, I must know what I've done. We've been through so much together. Why don't you like me? Why?
You left me for dead.
I did what?
Your cohort from the auto club had his hands around my neck, throttling me. You fled in abject cowardice.
I thought you had the situation in hand.
Oh, I was begging for your help. You just turned around and left. I thought, my God, what kind of man could just turn around and...
Blast! Blast, blast, blast!
Are you all right, Mr. Lyon?
No, I'm not all right, Detective. Your damnable contraption has given me the yips.
The yips?
The yips. I set up perfectly. I swing perfectly. And yet every time, disaster!
Well, I hardly think a machine can be held responsible
for... I may never win another golf game again. Not here. Certainly not in St. Louis at the Olympic Games. Whilst representing the fine people of Canada. Murdoch, you look like a dumb fool in those knickers.
Sir, what are you doing here?
He was just ahead of the foursome when Benedict went into the woods. He could have seen him, and he could have killed him.
But, sir, Mr. Lyon's cleats are not a match.
Mr. Lyon didn't have his cleats checked. You didn't go back to the clubhouse after your round, did you, Mr. Lyon?
Why would I? I had an engagement.
Oh, you saw what our constable was doing in there, and you buggered off.
Mr. Lyon, I need to see your shoe.
Is this because I insulted your contraption?
Your shoe.
George Lyon, you're under arrest for the murder of James Benedict.
There's one thing still bothering me. We know that Wilbur Benedict's putter was the murder weapon, but no one was seen with it that day. That means it had to have been stashed in the woods ahead of time. So the killer had to have known that Benedict would go into those woods. But how could George Lyon have known that? How could anyone have known that?
I have no idea either. Ooh, that's odd.
Now, what do you suppose is wrong with this little fellow?
That ball was amongst the ones that George found in the lake. It's possible that it was just a bad ball. But it's also possible that it was weighted on purpose. And if one ball was weighted on purpose, it's possible that others were also. Like the one that James Benedict hid into the woods.
A bunch of golf balls that don't work right, sir?
Sir, I cut one of those open. They weren't manufactured by accident. They were finely designed to veer off course when hit squarely.
All right. So Lyon gives Benedict this special ball. He knows that every time he uses it, he'll end up in the woods. So he goes there and waits for him.
Except that it wasn't George Lyon.
Are you sure?
Yes, I am. The victim would have noticed a weighted ball while putting on the 13th green. Therefore, the exchange had to have happened between there and teeing off on the 14th.
And George Lyon wasn't there.
The killer had to have been part of the victim's foursome. Ah, Mr. Lyon, I'm terribly sorry about this.
I don't want to hear a word of it. You did what you had to do in the pursuit of justice.
Thank you for understanding. While we have you here, I believe you might be able to assist us in our investigation.
This ball was made to veer off course.
My, 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 how unusual.
Do you know of anyone who would be able to manufacture such a thing?
I know just the man.
Take care of that for you. You can leave it with the caddy. Love him taking care of.
Virgil Graydon? Detective William Murdoch, Toronto Constabulary. I understand you manufacture sporting goods.
In all manner, sir. Cleeks, smashies, niblicks, carry bags, rubber tees.
Teeing pedestal made of rubber and wood. How ingenious. Never mind all of that. I'm here to discuss golf balls. Specifically,
I have several new models. But if you're after something truly special, you'll want the Monarch.
Oh, my. These appear to be
extra dimples for maximum distance off the tee.
Dimples would cause turbulence, but that shouldn't result in greater distance.
I'm sure you're happy with your Haskells.
I'll take a box of each. Now, have you ever been commissioned to make custom balls for any of the club members?
It happens on occasion.
Well, on this occasion, the balls in question were specifically engineered to veer off course. I know the balls exist, Mr. Graydon. And if you do not tell me who commissioned them, I'll be forced to charge you with impeding a murder investigation.
Me?
a murderer. What a preposterous notion.
Where did you get this?
It was found near James Benedict's body.
You gave Benedict that ball. You knew what would happen when he hit it.
You had planned to follow him into the woods, where you had previously planted the golf club, and murder your friend in cold blood.
Well, speak up. What do you have to say for yourself?
I have nothing to say, Inspector. Except that you have it right. This ball was intended for murder. And I am a murderer. I hereby honorably admit my guilt.
I never did like that little git. Glad we don't have to come across him any longer.
I'm sure George feels much the same way.
Well, Crabtree? Oh, it's all right. You're allowed to take some joy in the misfortune of others every now and again.
Sir, I would like to. It's just... I don't think Newsom is guilty.
He's confessed.
I think he's lying.
Why?
He's embarrassed to admit the truth.
What truth would that be?
That he's a cheater. That's what the weighted balls are for.
George, you think Mr. Newsom confessed to a murder in order to cover up the fact that he cheats at golf?
Yes.
That would be mad.
Yes.
He could be right, Murdoch. That twit values his pride over everything. I was once ready to hang him over a bloody maths puzzle.
But Mr. Newsom's account of the events is consistent with the facts as we know them.
Except Newsom claimed he only used the weighted ball for the murder. But we found another one in the lake.
Well, that's true. But how would a weighted ball help his golf game?
Find putt, old man. Top.
He used it to sabotage the other players.
If Driscoll or Sanders found out what he was doing,
then one of them could have used the tampered ball to commit the murder.
Daft bloody game. Afternoon, gentlemen.
Inspector, detective, to what do we owe the pleasure?
How is old Roger faring? I mean, a murderer, doesn't that beat all?
He didn't do it.
New information has come to light.
Oh, well.
Got my swing meal, mucker.
I'll need you to empty your pockets. I must ask, why did you do it, Mr. Sanders?
Because he wouldn't listen. I told him, and he kept doing it.
Doing what?
Cleaning his ball. During play.
I may be a novice, Mr. Sanders, but to my eye, the cleaning of one's ball seems a minor infraction. Mr. Newsom's transgressions are far greater.
Newsom's a fool. Never wins a single round. Benedict liked to win. He gloried in his victory every chance he got. And when I cried foul, he accused me of being a poor sport. Me.
You murdered a man over a breach of etiquette. Hardly the definition of a gracious competitor.
Golf is a game of order. Without order, what do we have?
Without order, we have nothing. Constable, take him away.
Mr. Newsom?
Oh, Constable Crabtree, thank you for coming. As I am fated to die, there is something you must know. I did abandon you that day. I know I can never make it up to you, but I hope you can find some solace that the Lord has chosen you to live and seen fit for me to die.
You're not going to die, Mr. Newsom.
You mean you know the truth?
And against my better judgment, I spoke up.
The club doesn't know about my cheating, do they?
I'll try not to mention it.
You're a fine man, Constable. If any good is to come of James's death, I'm glad for it to be the salvation of our friendship.
Don't push it, Newsom.
Righto. But really, I must make it up to you. You'll have to come out to the house for supper sometime. Mother would simply adore you.
Oh, perhaps you can court my sister. She's quite the beauty. We have the same profile.
All over, Detective. I cannot shake these yips.
Perhaps we simply didn't use the swing machine enough, is all.
It's no use. My dream of the Olympic Games is dead.
Good afternoon, gentlemen.
Julia.
I was able to leave Roland with Miss James for the afternoon.
Well, you decided to join us. Welcome. Afraid we won't be very good company, but give it a go, Doctor.
Now, Julia, you'll want to align your left shoulder with your forward foot and angle at the waist.
Oh, William, don't bother. I don't expect to be any good. I just came to play to have a little fun. Oh! Well, that is fun.
How did you do that?
I don't know. I just did it.
Yes, but what were you thinking? Were you focused on the ball or the club or?
I was thinking nothing, Mr. Lyon.
Well, surely you were thinking of something.
No, I just emptied my mind.
Emptying your mind. Emptying your mind. Yes! By Jove, dear lady, I do believe you saved me.
I'm glad to have been some help.
Ah! I am doing it properly. I know I am.
Empty your mind, Detective. It works. It really works.
Empty your mind. That simply doesn't make any sense. How does one empty their mind? It's impossible.
May I have another?
Just leave me, Julia. This is something I must do on my own.